But recognize the Bronx right now, okay? Recognize New York right now, okay? Recognize African-American genius right now. Shout out to all of y'all. But don't forget where this culture comes from. Don't forget who your teachers are. And this is what happened with the pyramids in Egypt and Kemet. This is what happened to our ancient civilization. We freely gave it to everybody. Said, yo, come on and be part of this, man. This is about humanity. Come on and be part. So everybody comes and be parts of our thing. Then they take it back to their culture and manipulate it in their culture. Then say they did it. Then they take it back to their culture and manipulate it in their culture. Then say they did it.
Right.
They, we did this. You know, generations later, where everybody forgets. Now it's we did it. And now your children is from the family of the originators of this thing. They can't even get a job in these people's community. They can't even live in these people's community. They can't even set up a business in these people's community. But they took your legacy and put it in their culture.
All right, so I'm back here with DJ FaZe. FaZe, I wanted to add on a little about what we were talking about, that other video, and he put up a video about Mr. Dyson, Michael Eric Dyson.
Yes. And in the beginning, I know Fat Joe took a lot of heat on this. Black and Latino culture produced hip hop at its very roots and beginnings, right? All kind of scholarship is done about this.
Right, and I just wanted to get into that. What you think of that? First of all, what you think of that?
Well, the comment that I put was, since when did Michael Dyson start smoking crack and dust at the same time? That was my comment.
Why you say that?
Because like he had to be on some type of drugs to say something that was illiterate. Is that
what that he said? It sounded like
Puerto Ricans started hip hop.
And he added the word culture.
Black and Latino culture produced hip hop.
And culture, yes.
Right. So Puerto Rican culture didn't have nothing to do with starting hip hop?
Nah. Right. Not at all. Not no part of any Spanish culture started hip hop. So don't just say Puerto Ricans, any Spanish culture had nothing to do with the creation of hip hop.
Right. Shout out to Mr. Dyson. My message to Mr. Dyson would be to come to the Bronx, you know what I'm saying, and ask the real people who was involved with hip hop at the start. You know what I'm saying? Come and talk to Coke LaRock. Come and talk to Sasa, Trixie, DJ FaZe, Kool DJ D. Nowadays, we got some pretty well-known rappers speaking publicly about their opinions about hip hop started from Jamaican culture and Puerto Ricans was 50-50 in the creation of hip hop. You agree with that?
No.
Okay.
Hip hop to me, the birth of it was an all black thing.
We put it too straight up. There wasn't no Puerto Ricans.
Wasn't no Puerto Ricans.
Coming
wow.
to the parties.
How diverse were the parties?
Initially, they weren't really diverse initially.
Right.
Initially.
Like, how many of those B-Boys between 73 and 75 was Spanish, Puerto Rican, or? Do you remember?
Well, in the owl circle, hey, Scout's Honor, man. Scout's Honor. In our circle, it was one.
One.
Johnny Cool.
Was there any Puerto Ricans breakdancing at that time?
One or two. They ain't like how they took it over.
Some people don't even remember Johnny Cool. And when they say Spanish, because he looked at black. So there's some people that probably didn't even know he was Spanish.
So y'all want to know the truth? No. Spanish Brothers was not breakdancing in the 70s. Mm. 71, 72, 73, and 70. Matter of fact, they barely came to some of our parties.
Sasa, Trixie, DJ FaZe, Kool DJ D. Because there's a big difference between what Fat Joe say, KRS-One say, and what the people who was actually there would say.
But so, I think that goes back to what we were saying. It's about a financial thing. See, anything that he's seeing has been on a financial status. He's not saying any, he's not coming to anybody that wasn't paid to do something or say something. He's never reached out to anybody without that financial backing behind it. So all the stories that you're hearing, all the everything that he's the things, because none of it is recollection. Okay. In other words, none of it is recollection. It's just like we always say, hearsay.
Right.
So if he's hearing all of these things, he's getting the stories from someone that was paid to say that this is what this is, right, and this is what that is.
Right. And that's a good point, and that's the truth. Like, a lot of the hip-hop history that we know of is really based on hearsay and rumors,
right,
and half-truths.
Because a lot of hip-hop, to me, is propaganda.
So, and then Mr. Dyson, what they're doing also, they're trying to link Caribbean culture with the start of hip-hop, which is just totally false. Did you see any signs of a West Indian feel back then in any of the parties? Did it feel like a Caribbean thing?
No, not to me.
Okay.
Not to me.
You said Herc didn't bring the break beats or none of that from Jamaica, right?
No.
Okay. So one thing, they try to say that hip hop came from Caribbean culture.
No.
It didn't. It was it a Caribbean feel?
No.
In the street, right.
Did you hear that beat? Did you hear that beat?
Right.
Well, none of that was at Herc's part. Everything was Black American.
And did he play slow music too?
Would he play reggae?
Nah, he wasn't a reggae guy.
He didn't play no Jamaican music.
Mr. Dyson, what they're doing also, they're trying to link Caribbean culture with the start of hip-hop, which is just totally false. So, you know, like, in order to understand how hip-hop began, we have to put our minds back to that time frame. And basically, a good way to do it, I think, is to look at the early Soul Train. Soul Train, you know what I'm saying? That was the vibe in the streets, in the Bronx streets. It was, you know, power to the people. It was a whole different vibe.
Right.
When we came out, everybody went Dashiki's Afro and saying Peace Brother and Power.
Well, you know, I could go in any one of these doors over here and say I'm hungry and get something to eat. They didn't even have to know me.
Power to the people was a whole different vibe.
Right.
And back in those days, 1973, 1972, 1971, Puerto Ricans was much more into their own Puerto Rican culture.
As a matter of fact, everybody used to get so pissed off with the Spanish if they were talking, man, talk fucking English, you know.
1973, 1972, 1971, Puerto Ricans was much more into their own Puerto Rican culture. They did not associate with the hip-hop circle like that.
And not denying what they call it, because they probably call it where they was at. But if they was at Herc, they would know what we call it.
Right.
But you can't say that what they saying never existed, because it probably, what it did, it existed in their circle.
Right.
You know, in their circle.
They did not associate with the hip-hop circle like that. Exactly. And that's a very important thing to understand. And, you know, on top of that, it's like, you know, it might be hard for outsiders, like people from different states and different cities, to understand the Bronx, you know what I'm saying, the Bronx makeup, especially back then. Like, back then, people might think that the Bronx is just all Latino. And nowadays, it kind of is. It's like,
I don't call this the Bronx no more.
What you call it?
El Bronco.
And nowadays it kind of is like.
But you made Latino a point Chico. With that. You made a point with that too. Also, you said about the, you know, KRS with the South Bronx. South Bronx.
Right.
So, you know, the part in which I grew up with was the any of the Latinos, most of them were the older Latinos, and they had private houses.
Okay,
so they weren't, you know, they were the ones that been here, and they had private houses, and the ones that lived in the actual projects where I lived at, they really didn't associate with the other part of the Puerto Rican thing. So their culture became riding off of our culture.
Right.
So in other words, if we had the 69ers, because they saw us with the 69ers, then they were wearing the 69ers.
Right.
But when you go back, to a lot of the fashion part of it, everything that I remember, recall, that we were wearing, we wore first, and then when it was actually going out of style with us, they grabbed onto. And that's just a fact.
Right. That's a fact. To Mr. Michael Dyson, understand, back then, it was large areas of the Bronx that was predominantly African American.
Yes.
Like the Soundview area at that time, you know, was predominantly African American. You know, and that's a very important thing to understand. The Soundview area was predominantly African American. Yes, we had little sprinkles of Puerto Ricans, but it wasn't like that where, you know what I'm saying, like it was an equal amount of Puerto Ricans or nothing.
We actually had buildings that didn't have not one Puerto Rican family in it.
This whole Watson Avenue was 90% Jew.
That's interesting. When I came up, it was mostly, you know, Spanish children.
There was very few Spanish. As a matter of fact, everybody used to get so pissed off with the Spanish if they were talking, man, talk fucking English. You know, that was, there was very few. There was one or two families, maybe in each building at that time.
We actually had buildings that didn't have not one Puerto Rican family in it.
But there was more whites than Puerto Ricans.
On up Watson?
No, in the project.
Okay. So you saying it wasn't no Spanish Watson or Stratford and Boynton and all that stuff?
No.
Wow.
If there was, the only one, there was very few, period. Mm. Okay, they came after, the only difference, they came after.
Right.
Okay. We were the pioneers of this whole area other than the Caucasian.
In those days,
we
had we had a couple of buildings that had no Spanish in it at all. It was just, the whole building was African American.
Right. And so, and that's why it was surprising for me to see what Fat Joe said, because I've seen video where Fat Joe said he grew up in a 90% African American neighborhood, or he said black.
And I grew up in a 90% black neighborhood. Mm. And I grew up in a 90% black neighborhood. Mm. So I had to go hard since birth.
He said 90% black neighborhood.
Right,
but Fat Joe grew up in a 90% African American neighborhood. So how can he turn around and say hip hop started 50-50?
Right.
I saw a video of Fat Joe at a party, like in the middle 1980s. He was at a party totally outnumbered. He was like the only one, only Spanish dude. It might have been one or two others, but he was totally outnumbered in this party. And I think that's a good example of how hip hop started.
Right.
African American culture was totally dominating early hip hop.
And you even said that's the 80s. So imagine the 70s.
Exactly. And so these are important things for people like Michael Dyson, Mr. Dyson, and other scholars to understand. You know, like, see, but part of this problem, me analyzing this whole thing, it comes from these movies like Beat Street. You mentioned Beat Street. Now, see, the Beat Street happened in the early 80s, mid-80s now. And see, I think this is what confuses people, because in Beat Street, you see a lot of Puerto Rican B-Boys in there. You see like a nice mixture of Puerto Rican and African American.
Yeah, but they came in the 80s.
In the 80s. Yeah. Was it like that in the 70s?
No.
It wasn't like that?
No.
Beat Street and Wild Style and Breakin. And Wild Style is interesting because I think the guy name is Lee Quiñones. You know, analyzing how people got misled about how hip-hop started, I trace it back to those movies because they put Puerto Rican faces right. on those movies.
Right.
And even like Wild Style, they show like in the club or the party when they was performing, you look out in the crowd, you see 90% African-American faces.
Right.
But
right.
the face of the movie itself was it's Puerto Rican.
Spanish.
Now people clap your hands, clap, just clap your hands. Come on, while you're rocking to the beat of the two, and we got the master plan. So clap your hands.
Out in the crowd, you see 90% African American faces,
right,
but
right.
the face of the movie itself was Puerto Rican,
Spanish,
right? Puerto Rican.
Right.
Same thing with Breaking B Street.
Right.
They put like you know they did a nice mixture of Puerto Rican and African American B-boy.
And that's one of the parts of what we were hitting on the other day was that by the 80s,
right.
We have been on gave the breaking up.
73, 74, 75, because that's when I stopped dancing.
You stopped dancing in 75?
I was, I would say 75, 78?
Yep. 75, 74 even.
Yeah, just 74.
74 to 78.
What year you stopped, MC?
I stopped, what, 73, 4, 5, 6. Between 77 and 78, I stopped.
You stopped?
I stopped.
I stopped competing and stuff in 77. I really stopped really between 76 and 77.
When Sugar Hill Gang came out, you were still breakdancing at that time?
No.
Yeah,
no.
Stopped.
No, we pretty much stopped by then. But the Latino kids was.
We have been on gave the breaking up. You know,
right. It got played out.
It got played out.
It got played out.
And that's exactly what I've been saying.
Right.
You know, everything that we do, we do it. We do it done, and then we like kind of like whatever, and then they grab hold on to it, and then they take it from there
right.
and say that they did it.
Then they take it back to their culture and manipulate it in their culture, then say they did it.
Right.
And that's just not true.
And that's a good example. You
know, like, I'm never gonna take it away from our creator, the people that we created it.
Right.
Why would it, just because we gave it to you, can't say you recreated it.
I think what really misled people was those movies and also KRS-One's South Bronx.
Yes.
Because when he came out with that South Bronx, yeah, it gave us dignity from being from the Bronx.
Bronx
yeah,
right.
It gave us dignity, but at the right. same time,
it was taken away from the creation of where it came from.
Right, because the South Bronx is probably a nice mix of Puerto Ricans
right.
and African Americans.
Right. Right.
And so people always associate the start of hip hop with the South Bronx, that mixture.
Right.
But the problem with that is the two main groups that's claiming the start of hip hop is not from the South Bronx.
Right, neither group.
Right, right, neither group. The two groups that claim the start of hip hop is Coke La Rock, Kool Herc. And they call it the West Side.
This thing called hip hop
uh-huh.
that the West Side created.
Then I moved to the West Side.
Then I moved to the West Side when I was like in the sixth grade. And that's how I met Herc on the West Side.
The two groups that claim to start a hip hop is Coke La Rock, Kool Herc. And they call it the West Side.
Right.
And then it's our side.
We from the East Side of the Bronx.
So where would you say hip hop started?
Hands down, BX, baby.
BX?
BX.
Yeah, okay, that's
BX.
No question. BX.
Down. It started BX, and I believe it started right here in the East Bronx. Because it's two different sides of the Bronx, people don't realize that.
Right.
You couldn't be.
The East side of the Bronx. You know what? The East side is a big part of the Bronx.
Okay.
A lot of projects. I come from Lafayette, Boynton Avenue.
Okay.
Story Avenue between Lafayette, Morrison, and Boynton.
Then it's our side, the Soundview area, Mario and the Black Spades. Those are the only two groups that I ever heard that right. claim of starting hip-hop.
Right.
Flash,
right.
now Flash did great things, but he right. more transformed
right.
what was already going on.
Right.
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 Right. right.
So
and
that needs to be
a big part of it.
Right, right. And when you talk to Coke La Rock, Coke La Rock even said he only knew one or two Puerto Ricans. You know, when he went to school, he only knew one or two Puerto Ricans. So you saying us African Americans
yeah.
dominated.
Yes.
African Americans dominated.
Not personal.
Right.
When I went to junior high school, I only had maybe three Spanish people in my class. One Jamaican, maybe one other nationality.
And those Kool Herc parties, Coca Rocka Kool Herc parties, it was only one or two, literally one or two Puerto Ricans.
Now, and don't get me wrong. Just please, I don't want all the Puerto Ricans that I'm talking to right now. Don't get me wrong.
Uh-huh.
We're not even going to say that you were not there.
Okay.
What we're going to say is that you had nothing to do with the creation. We're right. talking about the creation. The creation of something means that we put it together.
Right.
Now, if you add it on something, you're not the creator.
Right.
You just add it on right. to something.
Right.
Okay, and so that's what Puerto Ricans did. They added on to what was already created.
Exactly.
And so I have nothing against Puerto Ricans. I got friends that are, and I hate to sound like the pink people, but I've been had childhood friends right. that are Spanish.
Right.
You know, I know some we Spanish.
Went,
yeah, right.
We went to grade school. I right, went to grade right. school with them.
Everybody right. loved right. The dinners and stuff that you get, you know, that I got from. So it's not that we have anything against you, because we totally don't. But we just would like y'all to stop saying that you created something
right.
and you didn't. Because
right.
we are already saying you added, just like us. We would not come over there and say we created salsa.
Right.
We would not come over there and say we created merengue.
And we might nothing. Have a right, right? Because doesn't a lot of that stuff go back to
exactly, but we
asking people. Right.
Exactly. And all of that stuff, just like, you know, one of the things that I was saying, do you know that we created the drums?
Mm.
Okay, so we created the drums. That's already signed, sealed, and delivered. We created the drums. So all of this break-in, all of this stuff goes back to the drums.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so we created the drums.
Right.
So this is our culture.
Right.
This is something that is in us, that our culture.
Right.
Okay, so we didn't come into something and say, okay, this is what happened. No, we created it and branched it out. Grew
right.
it, it grew out. And once it was growing out, then other people sprinkled in and started connecting and started right. added
exactly.
on.
And you know what's so deep,
what we
did. I saw KRS-One say the exact same thing you just said.
This is what happened to our ancient civilization. We freely gave it to everybody. Said, yo, come on and be part of this, man. This is about humanity. Come on and be part. So everybody comes and be parts of our thing. Then they take it back to their culture and manipulate it in their culture, then say they did it.
But he was making it in reference of people from India and, you know, far off nations. But no, that what he said applies to us here in the Bronx.
Right.
We created things that Puerto Ricans and Jamaicans are trying to take claim
take
of what
claim.
We did.
But for what, though? What I don't understand is, what about our creations are so good
right.
that someone has to want to claim what we've done?
Mm.
So in other words, basically this. What do they want to say that we created? What?
Mm.
If we can't, if there's somebody that created the music, okay. Somebody created the MCing, okay. Somebody we created the fashion, okay. Somebody created graffiti, okay. So what are they actually saying that we created?
Well,
actually, I really want to know,
right.
what do they want to say to you?
They want to say we did it together. They want to do the whole Kumbaya United Nations thing. They want to say we did it together. They want to do the whole Kumbaya United Nations thing. And that's
but
the
why?
Because people love humanity and they want to say, well, all of us humans did it together. You know, that appeals to the humanity of the heart. You know, all of us humans did it.
But we don't want to do that.
Well, that's what they're trying to do.
Okay, we but we don't want to do that.
When they
you
say,
know that, right?
They say,
right, I don't
right,
want to do that.
Right. They say Puerto Ricans and blacks started hip-hop. That's like, and I want the people to understand,
that's like a slap in the face for us. That's disrespectful because going back to that video I saw with Fat Joe in the party, he was like a sore thumb sticking out. He was like the only Puerto Rican there. So looking at that party, like if that party was the beginning of hip hop, how can you possibly say Puerto Ricans and blacks started hip hop?
Right.
He's the only one there. So how can you say Puerto Ricans and black, and a lot, some people put it first, like Puerto Ricans and blacks started hip hop.
Even if you said
blacks and Puerto Ricans, I don't think that's an accurate way to describe that party. An accurate way to describe that party is African Americans and African American culture,
right?
And one or two Puerto Ricans was there,
right. Exactly.
African Americans started hip hop, and one or two Puerto Ricans was there. And like you said, that don't mean that they was contributing.
You could have been standing right here,
right?
But you didn't contribute nothing. You didn't create nothing.
Well, look. Crazy Legs would say he created the backspin or the windmill or something like that.
Okay, and that's why I give you those looks and everything. Right. That's why I give you those looks.
And I have nothing against the Rocksteady Crew, these guys.
Right.
You know, and that's how they got on TV and, you know, the B-Boy and all that. But, you know, that was their era. They used to dance on cardboard.
But, you know, you just showed me a real good point, right? Uh-huh. So now, let's go with the word, the N-word, right? Okay. That word is devastating to us.
The N-word, okay.
The N-word, right? But now, you hear them saying it about themselves.
So I thought I was the toughest nigga in the world.
Okay, that's my N-word. Yo, this, every out their mouth.
Okay.
You know what I'm saying? So, in reality, everything that we basically do, they want a part of it. They want to say it's theirs and that we're saying. Then, the part about it is, right, they go and they say, oh, you could trace my great grandmother or my whatever, and they were black.
Right.
Right? But yet and still, they say, they claim it. The Puerto Rican culture.
So you come and you take from our culture and go back and say, okay, but I'm really Japan. I'm really Japanese.
Right.
No, that has to come to a stop.
It boggles me. Like, which one is it? Yeah. Which one is it? So, all right. So let's say this. So what they basically want to say is, because you just said it, they want to say us and this, they had a part of the creation or whatever.
Right.
I always ask this question. What part?
Right.
Well, we did the music?
Right.
No.
Right.
We did the fashion? No. We did the DJing? No. We did the MCing? No. What part of it, of these elements did they create?
Well, they would say, like I said, Crazy Legs, whatever, but message to Mr. Dyson to understand. They're talking about after 1977, and most likely after the blackout of 1977.
Right, when everybody...
Right, that's when things changed with hip-hop.
That's when things changed with hip-hop.
And that's when a lot of Puerto Ricans started migrating into hip-hop.
In 1977, Africa Bambaataa called me for an interview by the Western Projects going up the stairs. And I approached them because I was asking the kids around there, yo, who's Africa Bambaataa? They said that big guy right there sitting on the ledge of this bar. And I go up to him and I say, excuse me, your name is Africa Bambaataa? And he's sitting on this thing and he goes, yeah, what's up? I said, you called me here for an interview. He said, wait a minute. Who are you? I said, my name is Batch. I'm the president of TBB Rocking Goon. And he started laughing. He said, wait a second.
And that's when a lot of Puerto Ricans started migrating into hip hop.
Right.
And that should be understood in hip hop.
Right.
That should be thoroughly understood.
But that was how many generations after we created it?
Right. Right. Now, Faye, some people would say, well, 71 is too early. They were still doing disco. And you know what's interesting? 71, I was doing some research. I don't find a disco song in 1971.
Okay. Can I please stop you with this?
Yeah, yeah,
okay,
go ahead.
Because I'm going to go in. All right. Anybody that says disco
was before 75 is not a musician. Okay? And so if you're a musician and you come and tell me, another thing, if anybody that tells me that before 1975, they have a disco record, okay, please tell me what that record is.
Right.
Because I have millions of records.
Right.
Okay? Now, the disco beat is different from what discotheque music is. Okay? So they have to first establish what's the difference between disco and discotheque.
Right.
Discotheque is the club right. in which they play the music.
Right.
So in the discotheque, they can play disco, rock, soul, R&B, okay, inside of the discotheque. Okay? So as us before when we were kids, we were not allowed in a discotheque. Okay? So our music was not coming from the discotheque.
Right, exactly.
Okay, so now disco did not start, and me personally, that I know that I'm a drummer, it didn't start until the bicentennial. And those that don't know, that's the bicentennial was 1976.
Okay.
Okay. So all those that say that they were playing disco, no.
Right.
All right. No. That's just wrong.
Right.
That's wrong. So they don't know.
You know what it is, FaZe? I realized they trying to call funk, soul, and R&B music disco.
Right.
That's
exactly.
what it is. They right. trying to say that that's disco.
And that's because they don't, like I say, all of these people that are saying this is hearsay, number one.
Right.
And they were nowhere inside of, like I said, they were have nothing to do with behind the rope. Okay, you used to say that people used to on Broadway and stuff used to say behind the scenes.
Okay,
because the people that are behind the scenes are the ones that bring it to the public. Okay, so you don't know what the difference between a disco record, a soul record, a R&B record, a funk record. You know, they don't know the difference. All they know is, hey, people are liking this music, this regular, or whatever, and that's what it's going to be called.
Okay.
So there's a total difference. And musicians, that's what I want you to do. All of those people that said the disco was first before hip-hop, ask a musician.
You know, and I asked...
Ask a musician.
Listen, I asked Coke the Rock. Me and Coke the Rock talked about this, and I asked him about disco. And he said, whenever Donna Summer started,
that's disco.
We knocked that out the box.
Now right. a guy just jumped on me. Why are they giving Coke the Rock an award? What are you saying, man? They'd have still been in disco. Y'all might be ladies now because it's legal.
When would you say disco started? Because we was trying to figure that out.
Yeah, after Diana Summers. I'm going by music.
Is that 75?
She was out. Whenever Diana Summers Diana was out, Summer. We killed Diana her. Summer. We killed
that. I think that was 75.
Okay, like I said.
So then that way, if that was 75, then that would mean that hip-hop came before disco.
Yeah, yeah. It was not in that manner, you know.
Okay.
That's how I just felt. Like as far as where...
He said, whenever Donna Summer started...
That's disco.
We knocked that out the box.
That's right.
And it's interesting because I started researching Donna Summers, and what I realized is it says that...
77.
Wait, hold up. Donna Summer, they say, made an album. I think it was her first, maybe, album in the U.S. in 1974. It was okay. called Lady of the Night, I think.
Right, but that wasn't and, disco.
Right, it wasn't disco.
Was not disco.
When you listen to it, it's
R&B.
Right.
Taking like a stone that you've thrown in the-
not disco. Right. Her first disco hits was, like you said, I think 75, 76, 77.
Yep.
Donna Summer and Gloria Gaynor. Donna Summer and Gloria Gaynor.
Right.
Some of the first disco records.
Right. Gloria Gaynor. Okay. So, right. And then what's so bad about it, right, is that number one, disco is one of the easiest musician songs to play, especially for a drummer. Mm. A drummer is nothing. No nothing to the bass drum, nothing to the snare drum, and nothing to the hi-hat. So that's number one. Keyboards, same thing. Basic, 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 basic. Right. Basic chords, basic chords. Guitar, same thing. Basic chords, basic chords. Then that was the era when it turned from regular acoustic drum sets and acoustic instruments to the electrical instruments. And that's the deep. So you can program a drum machine with already has preset drums in it. And that's the difference. Ah.
Right. Right.
So you have to ask a musician before you make those statements.
Mm. So, you know what I'm saying? To put a cap on it and for the people to understand, Puerto Ricans and Puerto Rican culture, especially Puerto Rican culture, had minimum to nothing to do.
Don't say minimum. Don't say minimum. Don't say minimum, okay?
Okay.
Say the truth. Absolutely right. Nothing to do with the creation of hip-hop music.
Well, I say minimum because we had Puerto Ricans in Bronx there with the Spades. That's why I say minimum. And
Tex never played a Spanish song.
Okay.
You go ask Tex.
Right, right.
Tex never played any Spanish song.
But he's Puerto Rican, so he get a couple of.
But he's half Puerto Rican.
He's
half Puerto Rican. All right, so let's get that straight.
And that's another good point, because Kool Herc, his dancers, from my understanding, like Sasa, he said in his whole B-Boy career, he knew one Puerto Rican and one Jamaican.
So, out of your experiences as a B-boy, you remember one Puerto Rican and one Jamaican?
Yeah, straight up. Wow. Straight up. And you're talking to somebody who was deep into the scene. Of
right. In his whole B-boy career. And so, it was, and that one Puerto Rican looked like us. People thought he was us.
Some people don't even remember Johnny Kool. And when they say Spanish, because he looked at black. So there's some people that probably didn't even know he was Spanish.
So you say all of y'all was basically African-Americans?
Oh, yeah. Without right. a doubt. Okay. Without a doubt. Now, Dancing Doug is half black, half Puerto Rican.
Puerto Rican, right. I heard that.
But he's blackness. So you would never know that he was Puerto Rican.
Right.
Because he uses, when I found out he was Puerto Rican, I was like, wow, yeah. Fuck out of here.
Yeah.
He had nothing like this stuff. Matter of fact, I didn't even hear him speak Spanish.
Right.
You know, they it was taboo to a lot of dudes, you know. Mm. Oh man, if I'm gonna hang out, I ain't gonna tell the motherfuckers I'm Puerto Rican. Or because I think his dad is Spanish and his mom's is black.
Okay.
So his real heritage is Puerto Rican.
Okay.
You know what I'm saying? But he didn't act nothing like he was a fly motherfucker.
Yeah. You know? He didn't act Puerto Rican, and by looking at him, you wouldn't know he was
Puerto
Rican.
Listen, that's my homie.
Right.
And
that's like the only, like, but like other than only,
that. Right. Oh, I mean, that was like the only dude that you could say that was
right
Puerto Rican, or you don't know what to say.
Right.
Because he didn't look Puerto Rican.
Right.
You know, he looked black. So, no. Rather than that was the only dude that gave me a dung in my pants. He used to come at me all.
And that boy, yeah, Puerto Rican, yeah, looked like us. People thought he was us.
If he was half.
Right. And that's the thing about Dancing Doug. He was, so in Cool Herc parties, from my research, it was 1.5 Puerto Ricans at the parties. Because Dancing Doug get a half, because I think Dancing Doug is half Puerto Rican.
I'm half Puerto Rican, so, you know, that's what I tell people, don't get caught up in that black and brown crap. Don't, do not. Don't.
So it was literally 1.5 Puerto Ricans, right, in 3 or 4 year span.
Right.
This is a 3 or 4 year
and
span.
And so now, that half of Puerto Rican, right, was not even the creation. It was just dancing off of already the stuff that was already created.
A lot of this stuff with the ethnicities and everything got mixed and mumbled because people still associate the South Bronx with the creation of hip-hop, because the South Bronx has a lot of that was where the high concentration of Puerto Ricans was, and that's the problem. But people have to, you know, redo their mind and understand hip-hop did not start there. It did not start in the South Bronx.
And so I put out the record South Bronx. Right. And today, to be scholarly correct, hip-hop started in the West Bronx. It never started in the South Bronx.
It did not start in the South Bronx. And I think that's why when I talked to Coke LaRock and them, they made it their business to say West Bronx, West Bronx, West Bronx. Right. West Bronx. They kept saying West Bronx, West Bronx.
The West Side creates.
Like the ones I seen on the West Side.
Into the West Side area, I had met up with Coke LaRock's brother.
Then I moved to the West Side, and that's how I met Herc on the West Side.
They made it their business to say West Bronx, West Bronx, West Bronx. Right. West Bronx. They kept saying West Bronx, West Bronx. Right. Not once did they say, we was in the South Bronx and we did this and we did that.
Right. Exactly. And I'm so proud, like I said, y'all, I'm so proud that you know, I have this platform to actually put out the exact truth.
Right.
I have to say something on this video too.
Uh-huh.
The guy that does the videos or whatever, he says that he put out 3 times for me to do a live with him on his channel.
Okay.
I say this. Get Fat Joe to be on your channel, on your live. You know, get that whatever on your day.
But no, right? We don't need more Fat Joe with his input. Really,
that's just like saying, you know, I'm gonna come down to that level,
okay,
to be on your show. You know what I'm saying? I consider myself on a different level to come down, and so you're not going to get a response from me. I'm not coming on your show.
Right.
It's simple as that.
And it was, you know, so deep.
And you know that. You could say 1,000 times that you put out a request for me to come on your show.
Right.
That's not going to happen.
And you said, you said in Parkchester, you said that they need you is so deep, Faze. Yeah. Listen. No, right. I could magnify that by 1,000 and on a point that, and see that it's so deep what this is, because when you study history, they always needed us.
Right, right.
Low melanin people, low people with low melanin in their skin needs brown skin people to function. But they mistreat us so bad.
They mistreat us so bad, but
we don't need them. And I hope for our future generations, we could get to the level to under. They could get to the level
it's
to understand.
It's getting there. So I'm not going to light up your video channel just by DJ Faze me and all. It's so bad enough that you say my name. It's so bad enough that you put me in the title and everything, you know, because you need that for views.
Right.
And which was so funny, though, when you look at all of his comments, all of his things, he gets 1 or 2 likes. Any comment that I make, get 9, 10, 11, 12 likes. Yeah. So that's to tell you right there, brother.
Yeah.
I'm not coming on there.
150 times. Oh, did you ask me to come on there? And you got no response. Here's your response.
Right.
I'm not coming on there. Right.
Right. Yo, you know, he should get the people that was really
right.
present
right.
in early hip hop.
Right. And then, you know? And like I said, everything that he said, everything that they did, because I'm still waiting for the response. This is the response, I mean, because he always goes to something different. Oh, you said 77 over there. And then his own people said, yo, there's a million things where Crazy Leg say is 77.
Right.
So it's not just me. Okay. Oh, you did the interview, whatever. Anyway, the bottom line was, I said, in music, what are the British Walkers, the Playboys and everything, which ones did the Puerto Rican culture bring out, create? Nothing. I asked them the music part, the DJing part, the scratching or whatever. Which one did the Puerto Rican culture come out with? Nothing. Crickets. I asked them again. I said, you know, all the fashion, whatever. Nothing. Graffiti, the stick letters, the bubble letters, the crown letters. Which one? Nothing. Mm. So everything that I'm saying, the elements, the parts of hip-hop culture,
right.
there's nothing. He cannot come up with one thing.
Right.
Not one thing could he come up with. Mm. So that's your answer. That's your answer. When you come up with one part of the creation of hip hop, then I'll respond to it. But until you do that, I'm not responding no more.
All right. So to Mr. Dyson also, we want to make it clear, the brown skinned Puerto Ricans that was present at the start of hip hop, we salute them. We got love for them. Salute to the Puerto Ricans in Puerto Rico with their struggle for more, you know what I'm saying, more equality.
Seguimos viendo cómo nosotras, las negras y los negros, no estamos representados en espacios de poder como el gobierno, como los medios de comunicación y otros espacios que son muy importantes para la dignidad de nosotros como pueblo afrodescendiente.
Some people don't even remember Johnny Kool, and when they say Spanish, because he looked at black. So there's some people that probably didn't even know he was Spanish.
You know what I'm saying? And we don't want to make it where the other complexion of Puerto Ricans get the credit and the brown skin Puerto Ricans don't, because
right.
that's what's been going on throughout history.
Whoa,
you know what I'm saying? Brown skin right. people innovate things and right. then their counterparts right. will take all of the credit.
Right.
So in America, we was the brown Americans, we created things, and then the other Caucasian Americans took the credit.
Right.
And it's the same thing in Puerto Rico, Dominican
right.
Republic.
Right.
There's brown skinned people that do the work,
right.
and then the other complexion take the credit.
Right.
So we don't want the other complexion of Puerto Ricans to right. take the credit from the brown skinned Puerto Ricans.
Right.
You know what I'm saying?
Exactly.
Word.
Exactly. And that's a point well made and well Word. Stated, because, you know, that's exactly what happens.
Right.
That's exactly what happens.
Right.
You know, they the darker skinned Puerto Ricans are the ones that will tell you straight up that they are on this side. That half does not really count. And then you look at the other, the ones, the lighter skinned Puerto Ricans, that think that they're really pink people. And so they right. think that they should blend in the pink people.
What is the color for them? Because we call Caucasians yeah. pink.
Right.
What is Puerto Ricans?
Puerto Ricans are actually, yeah, some of them are pink too.
Pink too.
Some of them are pink too.
Right.
But then the ones that are, you know, that do go down to having, you know, us in there, they turn a little bit beige.
Beige, right.
All
right,
so they turn a little bit beige, right. which is on our seat, because we're all shades of brown, us.
Right.
We're all shades of brown, so. You know, and you can see the lighter skinned Puerto Ricans look down
right.
on the darker.
But look, at what you just said. Now, this is a thing that I'm just getting into. We say light skin, and see, those are those trick English words,
right?
That have double meaning, because
right.
light is like the light of the sun.
Sun, right?
They're not
yeah,
light
right.
of the sun.
Right.
We say
right.
light skinned people. Light, no,
right.
see.
So, dude,
right.
so we should. I've got to find out
less
a way
melanin.
To say
less melanin.
Right, right.
Less melanin.
Perfect.
Less melanin.
The lesser
people.
Melanin.
Right.
Because you know, wow, that's a good point.
was, oh man, you know what's so funny? I saw this morning. They're saying, and you brought it up in one of your things too, that the thing in the skin where you can see under the skin.
Yeah, vitiligo.
Right.
Back in the day, they called it something else, though, I think.
Right. And so they're saying that that is the case of which where they even came from.
Where they came from. Vitiligo and albino.
Right.
From my understanding, that's where Caucasians came from.
Right.
Vitiligo and albino. You know what I'm saying?
Right. So that's deep, y'all. I'm going to go study that some more today, too. But that's deep.
Yeah.
So even if you say your culture, you might want to redo that because it might be your culture came from us anyway.
Right.
You know what I'm saying?
Right. Yeah, yeah.
So, okay.
All right, is there anything else?
I just want them to understand one thing. Michael Wayne TV is not to brag and boast that we did things first.
Right.
We're more to let it be known that where it started from and that we're not going to allow our creation be stolen by anybody.
Right, right.
Okay, so you know, it, sometimes it sounds rough, sometimes it sounds harsh, but the truth can be that way sometimes.
Right.
You know, I didn't mean for anyone to get offended about the high waters or whatever, but those was some of our snaps from day one.
Right. That's your experience.
That's my experience. Those are my snaps. So, you know, like one of the guys said on there the other day, how can he tell me about my experience? How can you tell me about what I see? And I did see that. I see a lot of Puerto Rican, Spanish, and they wore their pants like that.
Right.
And we would say, the flood is over, the land is dry.
Right.
Why you wear your pants so high? I wouldn't know that snap if I didn't see it. You see what I'm saying?
Right.
We wouldn't get caught that way.
Right.
We would never get caught outside like that.
Mm.
You see what I'm saying? We would never. And so the reason why I know that snap is because of I saw that.
One other thing about that other channel, he tries to point out the differences between what you and Green-Eyed Genie says.
Okay, and see, this is what the thing is with that. Genie is not talking about that he created hip-hop like that. He's not saying it like that.
Hip-hop can't be the music because when you play somebody else's creative art of a record, somebody else rehearsal, somebody else rehearsal that record,
right,
and then you play it on turntable.
So what is hip-hop?
So you can't say that's what it is because
hip-hop?
That's somebody else's creative art.
So what's hip-hop?
Do you understand? Hip-hop was a style and charisma and the money that glorified the music when we brung it out.
Hip-hop is what?
Hip-hop was the style and charisma and the glorify of the luxury of the thousands of dollars that individuals were wearing diamonds coming to the parties. Had nothing to do with the DJ because he was bummy. He had no money. He had nothing.
What he's saying is he took hip-hop to other places.
Right. And for them it was new.
And for them, it was new.
Right.
And so, like, fashion.
Right.
Genie is not a DJ. He's not an MC. Well, now he sings.
Yeah, he got some rhymes.
He sings and he
shout out to Green Eye Genie. He got some rhymes.
Word.
They stole my glory. They stole my fame. They took what's mine. And it's on again. And now I'm coming. I want it back. I'm on a mission. I'm ready to attack.
To all the rappers on the face of this earth, I come to y'all humbly cause I'm the birth. With love and dignity, that's what I project. Just show me the podium and give me respect. So I can talk to the world and let them judge that I created hip-hop. Can I get love? I challenge anyone who say I ain't it. If the glove don't fit, then you must acquit. Come, let me take you where the seed was laid. Prop the project home of the black space. The meanest gang in the Bronx back in
got the rhymes.
He got some rhymes now.
He's a true artist.
Right now, right. But when it first was created, that wasn't it. He was more into doing what he do, getting money.
Right.
Okay.
Right.
Green Eyes was totally, he was into getting money.
What was the Green Eyed Genie's, what was his place? What was his contributions to hip hop?
Genie, as I said, he was about, they was getting money. He was getting money. He was coming apart with the hip hop cologne on and traveling through. And you see on the side, you just didn't want to be just a DJ. You looking at how fresh they look.
And what was he wearing?
Like,
what was
green and white Pumas, man.
Green and white Pumas.
That was like obsolete back then.
Yeah.
You know, walking around with the afros, walking around with sheepskin vests on in the summertime.
Right.
And everything. So he provided for his by getting the money the way he got it. And by him doing that, he was all over.
Right.
He was all over. And so he took that swag, he took that flyness and everything. And y'all should be kind of grateful for him for taking those styles and stuff from out of here.
Right.
See, because when it started, a lot of people couldn't come to the deal.
Mm.
A lot of people could not come to the deal. Right. And even to this day,
another thing about, as far as like, this, the what appears to be discrepancies on Michael Wayne TV, I want to say that Michael Wayne TV is not rehearsed. This is a lot just freestyle. We just you know, start it up and start talking.
There's no script.
Right,
like,
no script.
I wrote this stuff down on a script.
Right.
And there's none of that.
So if you see any discrepancies or differences between FaZe and Green Eye, that's because they're dealing with what comes from their heart, from their own experiences, from their own memories. As far as like mediating everything and trying to piece it all together and put it together. So I would compare it really like Wu-Tang. Wu-Tang, they all had their own little styles and everything,
right.
Their own styles, and they came
right.
forth. So Michael Wayne TV, in a way, is like
right.
Wu-Tang of hip-hop history.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? We bring forth people to give their testimonies, and it's from their heart.
Right.
So, you know, yeah. So, you know, it's one of those things.
100%.
Word.
100%.
But one thing is for sure, you and Green Eye both say Barnstairs the foundation.
That's it.
And that's the commonality. That's the common denominator. Anything else?
Well, you good. We touched it. And if there is anything else, we're going to do it on the next one. Because
right.
anything y'all try to debunk, we got it.
Right.
Got it.
Do you remember like the early jams?
The early, yeah, hell yeah. I remember when the jams were in the carriage room.
Carriage room.
They started in the carriage room.
Started right around the carriage.
The carriage room. Yeah. Did you hear what he just said?
Hold on, hey, that's what I'm trying to get. In what building?
In 1750.
1715.
Carriage room.
What year? Do you remember years that was?
That had to be like, damn. That had to be like 70.
No, let me help you.
71. Because we were still in 123 then.
That's what I wanted.
Yeah, we were still
right.
And I went to 123 in 71.